Today's discussion is on anthropology, its relationship with humanities, including literature, folklore, cinema, performance, and performing arts. Now, let us have the introduction. Humanities study human culture. There are many ways to study this subject. It is divided into human race, human nature, humanness, and benevolence, etc. So the inquiry of this covers a wide area. The study of man in relation with literature, folklore, cinema, and performing arts is dealt under the humanities. So anthropologists get valuable information from these social sciences in different ways. Now we have anthropology and literature. Literature is an umbrella term which concerns poetry, fiction, drama, and criticism. All these emanate from imagination and also appeal to the imagination. Human emotions are mostly their subject matter, and they mix pleasure with instruction for imparting knowledge. Such writings have an artistic aspect too. Literature is a wonderful domain. It functions in the imaginative field. It gives us joy, laughter, sadness, wisdom, thought, etc. It provides us realization, giving a perspective on life. Literature gives us a picture of life indeed. Written literature was not there in primitive societies. Literature is found among them in the form of folklores. These folklores show that they possess a good knowledge about the subject matter, characters, and the style of a story. In dormitories, young boys and girls listen to various kinds of folklores which contain important information about the origin of their tribe, about the origin of creation, about the mutual relations among men and women, about the origin of various social institutions, etc. The folk literatures of the primitive societies are verbally communicated from one generation to another through the medium of oral folk tales. Next, we have anthropology and folklore. Folklore has an important place in every primitive culture. It is through the medium of folklore that the culture of a primitive society is transmitted from one generation to the other. The folklores contain the philosophy of the primitive people. How the world was evolved is a theme of many folklores of different tribes. In most of the folklores, a reference to the mutual relation of the people and their gods are expressed. Many folklores aim at socialization and point out how different offenses are punished by the supernatural powers in different ways. Descriptions about birds and bees and also the trees besides human beings are given in these folklores. In various primitive folklores of India, it has been shown how man depended on plants and animals. Very interesting folklores about the origin of different tribes are recorded. One of the interesting folklores of this kind was found in the Hu tribe. There are various versions of this meat in different tribes. The folklore relating to the origin of creation is prevalent in a different manner in Kamar tribe. God Mahadeo was once so annoyed by a mad jackal that he ordered the destruction of the world. An old woman overheard the curse, told her husband about it, and the two together went to a forest and hastily improvised a houseboat and loaded it with all necessities of life to last for 12 years. Then they placed their young son and daughter in the boat. Soon after, a deluge overtook the world, drawing the whole of mankind and also the earth. After 12 years, Mahadeo's anger subsided and he sent out his attendants to recreate the world. The young boy and the girl were discovered and Mahadeo adopted them as his children. Some art was procured from the teeth of an earthworm and the earth was created again. The boy and the girl were left on this earth. Several children were born out of the union. Mahadeva divided these children into various spheres and each sphere became the progenitor of a caste or tribe. It became clear from the folklore described above and prevalent in various Indian tribes that the folklores are more imaginative and entertaining than awe-inspiring. Their main function appears to entertain their listeners. A good number of similarities are found in most of the folklores of the world, and their subject matter is very much alike. Many hundred events are described in different ways in different folklores. Many folklores, like the story of Oedipus and Cinderella, found in Western tribes, are also found in primitive societies of India. In this way, folklores are important means to understand human culture. Next, we have anthropology and cinema. Cinema is an expression of stories, plays, or drama on screen. Indian cinema has become a full-fledged industry with actors, producers, writers, technical persons becoming profession for livelihoods. However, there has been an evolution of a parallel cinema which explores themes of discrimination, social injustice, and gender issues in a powerful way. Little attention was paid to a scientific study of the cinema of the Indian tribes. Cinema depicting tribal arts are on the decline everywhere in India because of confused judgments. Often condemnation of tribal cultures or an implicit disapproval conveyed through uplift movements have been induced into the minds of the Indian. Tribal folk distrust in, and in some cases, even distaste for their cultural traditions. The repository folk music and the folk dances of India could be for enrichment and inspiration for India's modern film artists. It is encouraging to note that dance and music performances by invited representatives of various Indian tribes now become a regular item of the official program for the annual Republic Day celebration at New Delhi. There are various aspects uplift standard of the everyday life of the Indian tribals. There are poverty, disease, and ignorance among the tribals of India. A lot has to be preserved and nourished for the good of the country as a whole, such as tribal art films. The concepts and methods of anthropology should be designed to secure an understanding of the tribal culture, the function of which is to secure human survival. But the problem is how exactly and in what form was anthropology to make its contributions. Next, we have anthropology and art. The search of beauty is an eternal craving of mankind. This earth does not always satisfy the material needs. Rather, it brings satisfaction to the mind and eye. The impulse arises out of an ascetic sense. Every individual responds to it in some way or the other. Art is, therefore, a product of a deep-rooted human urge and has been integrated with the life of the people as an instinct since the early days of human existence. The nature and the style of art vary from culture to culture. As culture regulates the patterns of behavior in a society, it revolves around specific beliefs and feelings. Therefore, cultural variations in artistic expression are quite natural. As per our modern outlook, we generally want an artist to be original and innovative. In general, artists are swayed by the creativity in their own style of creation. Often, they are more appreciated by the show of their originality. Commonly, two distinct lines of art are differentiated: pure art and applied art. Applied art aims at some utility rather than searching pure beauty and pleasure. On the other hand, pure art does not bother about utility. They express impulse and rhythm, which manifests the beauty and pleasure of life. Here, the sense of beauty comes from an abstract thought or images as conceived by the respective society. Culture exerts its influence by introducing the specific social values, metaphysical concepts, particular tradition, style, and techniques, depending upon the material apparatus available therein. Art is, therefore, nurtured in the society and ends in it. The values and the ideals of society guide an artist. The social genesis of an art can never be ignored. Various different other factors like geographical condition, climatic setup, economic atmosphere, mood of the artist, medium of working, etc. may also influence the creativity of an artist. A person who lives on a high mountain and confined there for the whole life will not be able to visualize the waves of the sea. Similarly, a desert dweller is unable to present the view of a snowfall on a landslide in his pictures, because artists always externalizes their ideas and perceptions to the art in an objective way. Anthropologists consider the artist's activities as one of the four basic social activities of human life. But it is a matter of surprise that how art appeared in the dim past, hundreds of thousands years back. What inspiration acted behind those ascetic activities? The anthropologists, art historians, art critics, philosophers all seek this answer. However, the various pursuits of creativity have been classified in a number of groups like visual art, oral literature, music, dance, etc. Among these, the visual art is the oldest as well as a tangible expression of thought. It includes drawing, painting, carving, engraving, sculpture, etc. Although much of the evidences have persistence, only a few have survived in the graphs, on implements, and on the walls of the caps. Primitive art cannot be termed as crude art, as some primitive forms of artistic expression are highly complex. They show martial techniques and sophisticated ideologies ranging from naturalism and realism to conventionalized abstraction. For example, Busman's art is naturalistic and at the same time full of vitality. Australians' art is abstract and symbolic. Eskimos' art is naturalistic as well as technically sophisticated. What primitive art lacks is the knowledge of perspective. Therefore, in no way they can be defined as an art for art's sake. Rather, here, the creativity was plunged in usefulness. Thus, ancient art was very close to the life of the primitives. An artist served the demand of the social life. Now, let us draw the conclusion. In fact, an anthropologist must have adequate knowledge of all the four basic studies of humanities before he can specialize in any one of the four, because they are all intimately interconnected. Man being a unity, the science of man ought to be a unity as well. Therefore, it is essential that in order to prevent specialization from leading to a check in the growth of knowledge, every anthropologist must strive to have sufficient elementary knowledge about all the four main sectional studies.